Diversions of a Painter, Las Meninas by Velázquez. Near right, the dwarf Nicolasito prods to arouse with his black shoes diminutive and cheeky Vito, the mastiff which would sooner snooze. Next to him, quaintly beatific, eyes fixed on some unseen, specific point of focus, the squat buffoon Mari Barbala stands immune to her surroundings. On the left hand, before a canvas turned from view, the artist is included too, absorbed in observation, deft hand poised with a ready brush to set down what, we do not know as yet. Mid-foreground, pert within attention, but still prepared to acquiesce in this elaborate invention, is posed the five-year-old princess, the setting's dainty prima donna. On either side, a maid of honour, one knelt in tender protocol, one tilted like a lifeless doll. On the back wall, what seems a painting of king and queen, alone among the canvases which there are hung in shadow, gleams distinctly, tainting with day the intimate half-gloom which stills that quarter of the room. An open door presents its splendid oblong of light, and, watching there, a chamberlain is held suspended with fascination on the stair. The room seems spacious, only cluttered by these few figures. They have shuttered all but two windows on the right, which shed their glow just out of sight. Behind the doll-like maid a pair of superfluous attendants stand, she, with turned face and gestured hand, prattling to him, quite unaware of her station. He, oblivious, stares at the canvas closed to us. What is the painting in the painting? If we could peep around the frame, what subject was Velázquez fainting in playing this reflexive game? In one sense, nothing, for, quite clearly, the work within the work is merely the canvas back and frame we see. The full front is a fantasy. As meaningless to pose the question as ask what Hamlet might have done or said 3 days before Act I, as fanciful as the suggestion a living person could declare that he is Don Quixote's heir. But art begins here to bamboozle. What seemed a portrait on the wall, at first glance, is, on close perusal, really a mirror after all. The silvered king and queen, detected in glass, turn out to be reflected from that position where they pose beyond the scene the picture shows. That canvas, then, is their depiction. So it is they the small princess and Mari Barbala address. Well, no, this is another fiction. Those mirror images depict no couple, but the viewer tricked. And now you see his game, his clever subversion of the paradigm. He's playing with you, viewer, whoever you are, or where, or in what time. He's almost starting to unnerve you, for aren't you placed within his purview precisely where the subject is? It's you that hooded gaze of his, standing back from the work, assesses within the work, or turns towards. It's you the portraitist records, you're the buffoon's and the princess's focus. Found out through time, you're brought to notice in the Spanish court. Enough, though, of these artful cruces. How did he really paint the thing? Mirrors may answer many uses. He placed one where the questioning spectator stands, in which reflection the room lay bare to his inspection. Dog, dwarfs, princess, maids, chamberlain, arrested and entranced within his block of light. And there to taunt us, Velázquez too, brush poised before an edge of frame. But there is more. The ghost of mirrors comes to haunt us now, for the picture that we know is in the picture has on show another easel, and a painter, dog, dwarfs, princess, maids, chamberlain, servants, which has a picture, fainter, smaller, which has an easel, in a spiral traced through time and distance with its grotesque counter-existence. Around each corner of a frame, you'll be confronted by the same, chasing Velázquez from this idyll of courtly life, beyond the rhyme of reason, beyond eye and time. The only way to solve the riddle? Cut short the regress, end the doubt, reach in and drag that canvas out.